Myself, Hariba Prasad Dhamarla, a retired deputy general manager from BSNL and ex-adjunct professor, EC department, PSMR College of Engineering and Technology, Vijayawada, AP. So this is the third part of introduction to and evolution to telecom switching systems. First, we will try to understand the basics of switching system. In this slide, we will try to understand the meaning of inlets and outlets. A major component of a switching system or a telephone exchange is the set of inputs and the set of outputs, and they are named as inlets and outlets. So the inputs can also be called as inlets, and the outputs of the switch are known as outlets. Either we can use interchangeably the terminology input as inlets, output as outlets. The primary function of switching system is to establish an electrical path between a given inlet outlet pair. So the switching system has to pair one inlet and one outlet. Then we consider that the switching has taken place from one inlet to one outlet. The hardware used for establishing such a connection is called switching matrix or the switching network. So whatever the hardware we use for pairing inlet outlet is known as switching matrix or the switching network. Then in continuation to our discussion on basics to switching system, now we will try to understand what is symmetric network. So in the figure, so this is a model of switch. It got N inlets and M outlets. Now let us go through the contents of the slide. Figure shows a model of switching network with N inlets, that means N inputs, and M outlets, outputs. When N is equal to M, the switching system or network is called symmetric network. So if the inlets and outlets are equal in number, it is known as symmetric network. Here, one example is given here. N is equal to 10 and M is equal to 10. Then it is symmetric network. So the inlets are 10 and the outlets are 10. The inputs are 10 and the outputs are 10. So we can make 10 pairs of inlet-outlet connections with the help of this switching network or matrix. In the symmetric network, the number of inlets and the number of outlets are equal in number. That's what we have discussed. Then, as part of the basics of switching system, now let us try to understand the meaning of folded network. What is folded network in switching system? Now let us see first the figure one. So here we are having subscriber inlets and subscriber outlets. Then similarly we are having incoming trunks and outgoing trunks. Okay. So subscriber lines or inlets are for interconnecting the called party and the the calling party and the called party of the same exchange. So the incoming trunks or the trunks are for interconnecting with another exchange. So you may be getting lines from other exchange, that is incoming trunks, and you may be connected to some other exchange via outgoing trunks. So this is the block diagram of a switch with both subscriber inlets as well as the subscriber outlets, and similarly incoming trunks and outgoing trunks. The inlets or outlets may be connected to local subscriber lines like this. Inlets subscriber lines, outlets also subscriber lines, or to trunks from two other exchanges as shown in figure B. So this top portion indicates the trunks from other exchange, and this side, right side, shows the trunks to some other exchange. When all the inlets or outlets are connected to the subscriber lines, the logical connection appears as shown in figure C. So let us assume all the inlets are subscriber lines only. Similarly, all the outlets are only subscriber lines. For a time being, let us forget about the trunks portion. All lines, all inlets are subscriber lines, inlet and outlet. So in such a case, the exchange is, the logical connection appears as shown in this figure C. What happens? A person, a subscriber, calls through inlets and he is connected to the called party through the outlet like this. Similarly, another subscriber, here two subscribers they have shown with the dotted, that means so many subscribers can be connected. So another subscriber, calling subscriber, is making to call to another subscriber and he is connected to calling subscriber like this. In this case, the output lines are folded back to the input. As you can see in the figure, it appears as if the output is folded back to the input. The output is folded back to the input. And hence the network is called folded network. When the input subscriber lines are connected to outputs, so it appears, the network appears to be a folded network. So this is the meaning of folded network. Then we will continue with some other concept. Here we will try to understand the basics pertaining to what are the types of connections that are possible with a switching network. Here also the same figure they have taken. So these are the subscriber inlets and right side subscriber outlets, and similarly the left side we have incoming trunks from one exchange, some other exchange other than this, and these are the outgoing trunks to some other exchange. Here there are four types of call scenarios available. So let us try to understand one after the other. First, local call. First, we will try to understand what is local call. It is the connection between two subscribers of the same exchange. So let us assume these are subscribers. A calling party, say subscriber A, makes a call to subscriber B. So the connection happens via outlet with the help of the switching matrix or network. So the calling subscriber and the call subscriber both are in the same exchange area. This is known as local call. Local call implies that both the calling and called subscribers are in the same exchange area, in the same locality. Then we will see the scenario of outgoing call. It is the connection between a subscriber and an outgoing trunk. So one subscriber of this exchange makes a call to another exchange subscriber. So the connection happens via switching matrix from subscriber inlets to outgoing trunks. The connection is like this. So these outgoing trunks are connected to exchange B, to which the subscriber of this exchange is making a call. When a subscriber makes a call to other exchange subscriber, it happens via outgoing trunks connected to the exchange B. So this cross connection like this is known as outgoing call. Incoming call, it is the connection between an incoming trunk and a local subscriber. So some other exchange calling subscriber is making a call to this exchange. Say you are getting a call from exchange B. Let us assume this is exchange A, what we are discussing, considering in this figure. So the calling subscriber of exchange B comes via incoming trunks and gets connected to this exchange subscriber via the outlet. This type of connection, the connection from incoming trunks to subscriber outlets or subscriber lines in the output, is known as incoming call. That means your exchange subscriber, exchange A subscriber is getting call from B exchange via incoming trunks. Then the fourth type is known as transit call. Okay, let us assume the exchange B subscriber makes a call to exchange C via exchange A. So the scenario can be perceived like this. Between B and C, there is no direct connectivity. They have to pass via this exchange A, what we are seeing in the figure. So B exchange customer makes a call. So he enters this exchange A via incoming trunks and gets connected to the C exchange via the outgoing trunks connected to C exchange. So exchange C is here, let us assume exchange C is here, exchange B is here. So the exchange B customer gets connected to exchange C customer via this exchange A from incoming trunks to outgoing trunks. The connection happens like this. So same thing is mentioned here, transit call. So this exchange is acting as a transit point, transit switch. It is the connection between an incoming trunk and the outgoing trunk. That's what we have discussed. Though the connection happens between incoming trunk and outgoing trunks. Okay. Now we will try to understand the basic concept of non-blocking network. What is non-blocking network? In a folded network with n subscribers, please note, in a folded network, what we have discussed earlier, with n subscriber, the search engine is having n subscriber, subscriber lines. There can be a maximum of n by 2 simultaneous calls or information exchanges. So, in an exchange with n subscribers, at any given time, maximum of n by 2 can only make calls. So here I have given one example. In a 600 lines exchange, maximum 300 simultaneous calls are possible. So this exchange, what we are taking it as an example, is having 600 lines. So a set of some 300 subscribers can make call to another 300 subscribers only. With that, all 600 subscribers are engaged. So that is the maximum possible, theoretically possible. Assuming that 300 people are making call to another 300 people. So all 600, either they may be calling party or called party, all 600 subscribers are engaged. So 50% of the exchange lines can make calls. Another 50% they can receive the calls. That is the maximum possibility with n subscriber lines exchange. That is theoretically, but it never happens in practice. It may be 20 to 30% only at a given time they make calls. Therefore, the switching net may be designed to provide n by 2 simultaneous switching paths, and such a network is said to be non-blocking network. So you have given provision for n by 2 simultaneous switching paths. You have switching elements which can take care, in our example, for 300 simultaneous calls. So here, all the 300 people, they are able to make call to another set of 300 people. Subject to the condition, the called party is free and is not already engaged by other customer. So such a network is known as non-blocking. So there is no blocking. All the 300 calling subscribers are able to speak with another 300 people. So all possible connections you have made provision in the switch or in your switching matrix or in your switching network. So this is called non-blocking. So no call will be failed unless otherwise the called party is busy. In a non-blocking network, as long as the called subscriber is free, that what I have told, a calling subscriber is always able to establish a connection with the called subscriber. So any calling subscriber can speak with the any called subscriber, subject to the condition the called subscriber is free, is not engaged in conversation with some other customer or subscriber. In other words, a subscriber will not be denied a connection for want of switching resources. So there is no possibility of subscriber getting the denial from the switching network for want of switching resources, because you have switching resources for all the 600 people. That means you do require switching paths for a maximum of 300 lines. 300 switching paths are available in your network. So everybody will get the opportunity to speak with other subscriber. Of course, the rider is the called party should not be busy. Now, having understood about the non-blocking network, we will try to understand the blocking network and the blocking probability. So let us go through the contents. In general, all possible conversation will not take place simultaneously. So as already I told, all 300 will not make call to other 300 set of called subscribers. So rarely, it never happens as a matter of fact. Therefore, it is economical to design a switching network based on the average maximum switching pass required. So in our example of 600 lines exchange, so the maximum theoretically possible connections are 300, 50% of the number of the lines, but it never happens. So therefore, there is no point in making provision for 300 switching parts or switching elements. So because most of the switching elements will be free and unused, and you are wasting the resources, and therefore the expenditure in establishing the telephone exchange. So it is sufficient by assessing the maximum possible connections at a given time or even in the busy hour, how many connections that are required. So based on that, if you design the switch, so it is just sufficient for our day-to-day requirements. However, in this case, it may occasionally happen that a subscriber is denied a connection due to non-availability of switching paths. This type of network is known as blocking network. So you have estimated that maximum, so there may be some 150 connections or 150 also higher side. Let us assume 25% of the subscribers are making calls. That is the highest possible. That means 1/4 of your 600 subscribers are making calls. So that is 1/4, 600 by 4, that is 150. So if you make provision for 150 paths, it is sufficient. But in such a case, there is a rare possibility when more than 150 connections are required. Let us assume of all 150 switching paths are utilized in a busy time. And suppose if a person, another person, makes a call at that time, so he will not get the switching path required for him to establish his call. So there is a rare possibility of blocking, non-availability of switching path. So that's why this type of network where we provide a less number of switching paths when compared to the maximum required, theoretically required paths, is known as blocking network. So the maximum possible in our example is 300, but I have designed the switch only for 150 simultaneous calls. So by an experience or by taking the statistics over a period, so in such a case, when all 150 paths are engaged, if someone makes a call, he will experience the non-availability, which is known as blocking. So this type of network is known as blocking network. In a blocking network, the number of simultaneous switching paths is less than the maximum number of simultaneous conversations that can take place. Let us take the same example. Instead of providing 300 switching paths for a 600 line exchange, that is the maximum possible, I have provided 150 only. Okay, so that is how we design the network, so which is technically known as blocking network. The probability that a user may get blocked is called blocking probability. So the rare chance of a user getting the blocking, experiencing the blocking because of non-availability of switching element or switching path is known as the blocking probability. Then, now we will try to understand about busy hour traffic. What is busy hour traffic? All the switching exchanges are designed to meet an estimated maximum average simultaneous calls, usually known as busy hour traffic. So we take some statistical information and we design our network for the busy hour. Generally, let us assume the busy hour is, say, morning after 10 o'clock. Let us assume between 10 and 12 is the busy time, or 10 to 11 is the maximum busy time when all the business establishments are opened and all the offices are opened. So you will experience more number of calls in that exchange. So we can term 10 to 11, for example, it can be termed as busy hour, where more number of or maximum calls are made in that exchange. As per the past records and experience, even in busy hour, the so-called busy hour, not more than 20 to 30 subscribers are active and use the telephone. Switching systems are designed taking this busy hour traffic into consideration. So let us take, so 30% is the maximum number of subscribers making call in busy hour. Say it is a 1,000 lines exchange. That means, so in a 1,000 line exchange, 30% means only 300 subscribers they may make call in even in the busy hour. So I have told that 10 to 11 is the busy hour, for example. So generally that is the busiest hour. So you will provide the switching network, or you design the switching network to take care of 30% of the subscribers. So that means for 300 simultaneous calls you can design. That means for 1,000 lines you do require 300 switching elements, network paths. Switching systems are designed such that all the resources in a system are treated as common resources and required resources are allocated to a conversation as long as they are required. So the resources are common for the entire exchange. For example, so the switching elements or switching paths. So earlier example we have considered for a 1,000 line exchange, 300 switching paths is the highest what we have provided. So these 300 switching paths is not dedicated to any set of 300 subscribers. It is a common pool. The resource is common. Whosoever is making call, he will be given one switching path from the 300 available. So the resources are shared as and when required. A switching path is provided to the calling subscriber to speak with the called subscriber. So the resources are common for the exchange. It is not devoted to any subscriber or any set of subscriber. So this switching path is required between calling party and called party till they speak, they finish off their conversation. Once they complete their conversation, the resource will be in general pool for available for any subscriber. It is something like, it can be conceived like DHCP, dynamic host configuration. So from the available IP pool, one IP address will be allotted for a subscriber for data communication as and when a customer, a user wants to have data communication like internet. So it is same on the same analogy. When the traffic exceeds the designed limit, a subscriber experiences blocking. The subscriber cannot access the network and make calls. So in the earlier example, what I have told, so 300 switching elements are there. So suppose if another person, 300 and first person makes a call, so he will experience the blocking because he cannot access the network because all the 300 switching paths are exhausted by other 300 users. Then we will try to understand the concept of Erlang. Erlang is used for measuring the telephone traffic. So let us try to understand what is Erlang. The traffic in a telecommunication network is measured by an internationally accepted unit of traffic intensity known as Erlang. So indicated by letter, capital letter E, named after an illustrious early contributor to traffic theory. So Erlang is one engineer who has worked on this traffic theory. So the unit is named after him. So it is a dimensionless unit. So just like you measure the distance in meters or time in seconds, so the traffic intensity in a telephone exchange is measured with Erlang. However, this Erlang does not have any this one dimension. The Erlang symbol E is a dimensionless unit. It is used in telephony as a measure of offered load or carried load on service providing elements such as telephone circuits or telephone switching equipment. So it is used for measuring the load on the system or the load carried by the telephone network. So this is the offered load or carried load on service providing elements such as telephone circuits, like switching elements or the telephone switching equipment. So we will try to understand what is Erlang. For example, a single circuit has the capacity to be used for 60 minutes in 1 hour. 1 hour, for how many minutes you can use a circuit? Maximum 60 minutes. Okay, now let us discuss about Erlang. If 10 6-minute calls are received on a group of such circuits, then assuming no other calls are placed for the rest of the hour, the total traffic in that hour will be 60 minutes or 1 Erlang. Now I will try to explain what is Erlang. So there are a group of circuits in a telephone exchange. Let us assume there is a group of circuits of 10. There are 10 circuits in the exchange for interconnecting the calling subscribers to call subscribers. They have taken 1 hour. In 1 hour, so for understanding purpose, we assume on all the 10 circuits put together, there are 10 calls, and each call is lasted for 6 minutes. On a group of 10 circuits, okay, it can be 10 or anything else. There are a group of telephone circuits. In that, there are 10 calls in 1 hour, and each call has lasted for 6 minutes. So that means there are 10 6-minute calls in 1 hour. So if there are 10 6-minute calls, totally all 10 circuits put together, they were engaged for 60 minutes. That is known as 1 hour long. So 60 minutes duration calls handled by a group of trunks or like switching elements is known as 1 hour long. It is not pertaining to one circuit only. It may be pertaining to n group of switching elements. If 100 6-minute calls are received on the group of trunks, then the total traffic is 600 minutes. So you are having, suppose, 100 6-minute calls. Okay? So each call we have conveniently, for explanation purpose, we have taken only fixed as 6 minute. So you have 100 calls. Each call lasted for 6 minutes in a particular hour. So total time used by all the subscribers, okay, by the group of trunks is 600 minutes. The group of trunks are engaged for 600 minutes. So that means it is 10 hour long, because 60 minutes can be considered as 1 hour long. 600 minutes means 10 hour long. Okay, 600 minutes means, okay, it is 100 hour long. So that is how you have to take into consideration. How many 6 minute calls are there? So 66 minute calls are known as 1 hour long. So if 600 minutes of calls are taken care of by the trunks, it is 10 hour long. Then we will try to understand the meaning of transit exchange. In a switching network, all the inlets and outlet connections can be used for inter-exchange transmission trunks. So switching network need not be used for only for subscriber lines or a combination. It can be exclusively used for trunks also. So here you see in this diagram, this is a non-folded switch. So there are n incoming trunks and there are n outgoing trunks. In such a case, the exchange does not support local subscribers and is called transit exchange. Because there are no subscriber lines, this type of exchange cannot support local calls, local subscribers. So it can support the calls coming from one exchange are routed to the calls to other exchange. It acts as an intermediate exchange for interconnecting the calls coming from other exchanges to the calls to some other exchanges. So for easy understanding, let us assume this is exchange A. There are n trunks coming from exchange B. There are n trunks going to exchange C. Okay, we have taken incoming and outgoing exchange also as one one only. It need not necessarily be one one. It can be multiples. It may be from two exchanges, three exchanges, and it may be to 3, 4, 5, 6, n number of exchanges. So there is no limit, but for easy understanding, let us assume C subscribers are making, B, exchange B subscribers are making calls to exchange C, and B and C are not connected. So they have to pass via this exchange A. So via incoming trunks they will come, and via outgoing trunks they will go, they will be connected. So this is known as transit exchange. Transit exchange is nothing but which got no subscriber lines. So the it got incoming trunks and outgoing trunks. A switching network of this type, as shown in figure D, is termed as a non-folded network first. And in a non-folded network with n inlets and n outlets, n simultaneous calls are possible. So from B, n trunks are there. So n number of subscribers from B can make calls to n number of C exchange subscribers, understanding that there are n outgoing trunks to C exchange. So inlets are n and outlets also n. The inlets are trunks, not subscriber lines. Outlets also trunks, not the subscriber lines. Therefore, in a non-blocking network supporting n simultaneous conversation, I repeat, therefore, it is a non-blocking network supporting n simultaneous conversations, because incoming trunks are n, outgoing trunks are n. So it can support n simultaneous non-blocking connections between the incoming trunks and the outgoing trunks. Then we will try to understand another concept known as control subsystem. While the switching network provides the switching paths, it is the control system of the switching system that actually establishes the path. So we are having switching paths in the exchange, but how the switching has to take place from one customer to the other customer is under the control of the one subsystem, which is known as control system or control subsystem. It is the brain behind for interconnecting the subscriber through the switching network. The switching network does not distinguish between the inlets and outlets that are connected to subscribers or to the trunks. The switching network on its own, it cannot distinguish whether the inlets are connected to subscribers or connected to trunks. Similarly, it does not know whether the inlets, outlets are connected to subscriber lines or to trunks. So it is the business of the control system to understand whether which line is subscriber line and which line is trunk, either in the inlets or in the outlets. It is the job of the control system to distinguish between these lines and interpret correctly based on the signaling information received on these lines. So it is the responsibility of the control system of the telephone exchange to distinguish between the lines as subscriber lines or as trunks, depending upon the signaling information received on the lines. So subscriber lines, they will have one type of signaling information. Trunks will have one type of signaling information. So based on the signaling information, it is the duty and responsibility of the control system to distinguish between the lines and interpret properly. It also senses the end of information transfer, that is call completion, and releases the connections. So this control system should know when the conversation is completed between calling party and the called party. Once it senses the completion of the information transfer or the conversation, so it has to release the connection. So it has to give command for releasing the connection between the calling party and the called party and make available the switching path for some other call. A connection is established based on the signaling information received on the inlet lines. So how a connection is established is based on the signaling information received on the inlets. So the signaling information available on the inlets is the criteria for the control system to establish the connection. The control subsystem sends out signaling information to subscribers and the other exchanges connected to outgoing trunks. Suppose in case of transit exchange or to another exchange call, so the call has to go via outgoing trunk. So the control system has to send the signal information on the outgoing trunks. Base on the signaling is to be sent by the control subsystem on the outgoing trunks. In addition, signaling is also involved between different subsystems within an exchange. So in the exchange itself, there are certain subsets or certain subsystems. So the signaling is involved between different subsystems within the telephone exchange. Say for example, there may be a subsystem for subscriber lines, there may be some subsystem for trunks, there may be some subsystem for control. So there should be intercommunication between inlets and outlets, incoming trunks and outgoing trunks, and control subsystem and some other subsystem. So it is all the signaling is required for various subsystems for intercommunication. Within the exchange communication also, signaling is required. That is what we are supposed to understand from this point. Now we will see the types of signaling. So we understood signaling is required for processing of the call and for also intercommunication of various subsystems within the same exchange also. Then what are the different types of signaling? The signaling formats and requirements for the subscriber, trunks, and subsystems differ significantly. Accordingly, a switching system provides three different forms of signaling. So the format of signaling for subscriber lines is different, and the format for trunk lines is different, and the format for subsystems within the same exchange is different. So therefore, based on the different formats required for subscriber lines, trunk lines, and subsystems, you have different signalings, different names of the signaling. Subscriber loop signaling, that is for subscriber lines, you do require subscriber loop signaling. The signaling required for subscribers is known as subscriber loop signaling. For inter-exchange communication, so inter-exchange signaling is required. So if a customer of this exchange wants to speak with another exchange, so you have trunks in between exchange A and exchange B. So the signaling required between two exchanges is known as inter-exchange signaling. And we have also studied there will be some intra-communication between different subsystems in the same exchange. Therefore, intra-exchange or register signaling is the another type. The signaling within the exchange is known as intra-exchange, or it is also known as register signaling. A switching system is composed of different elements that perform switching, control, and signaling functions. So, switching system is made up of different elements. So, some may perform switching functionalities, some control functionalities, and some signaling functionalities. Now, let us look into this diagram. Simultaneously, we will also look into the contents. First, let us look into the contents. Figure on the left side shows different elements of switching systems and their logical interconnections. So, this figure indicates different components or elements of switching systems and their logical connections. We will study one by one. The subscriber lines are terminated at subscriber lines interface circuits and trunks at trunk interface circuits. If you can see in the diagram, of course, one side is incoming, other side is outgoing. Okay, let us take incoming for understanding. So similarly, outgoing also, same replica will be there. Here, you can see here, these are the subscriber line interfaces. So subscriber lines are connected to these interface, subscriber line interfaces. This is the block which indicates the interfaces required for terminating or connecting the subscriber lines. Similarly, you will be getting trunks from the other exchange. So in the incoming trunks, they are terminated in the trunk interface block. So this interface is known as trunk interface. Then, the third one we will see, there are some service lines for maintenance and testing purpose. There should be some service lines for general maintenance of the exchange and testing of the exchange as well as the lines. They are called service lines. So this is the block for terminating the service circuits. So you see, where it is connected, these service circuits are connected to subscriber and service line scanning and distributor units. This we will try to understand in the next slide. Similarly, just we are understanding these blocks. This block is required for trunk circuits terminating in the incoming side. This block is required for inlets of the subscriber lines, subscriber inlets. This is for circuit for service lines, that is within exchange communication service lines. Junction circuits imply a folded connection for local subscribers and service circuits. Here you are having some circuits known as junctors. They are for folded network. Folded network means the same exchange subscriber A is speaking with B. So then the network appears to be as folded. That's what we have seen. And it is also required for service circuits. So the junctors are required for both for subscriber line interface as well as service circuit interface. Junctor circuits imply a folded connection for local subscribers as well as for service circuits. We have seen about the junctors. Next slide. Then we have here line scanning units, distributor units. Then we have one operator console. We will try to understand a little bit about these blocks. Line scanning units. This is the line scanning unit. Of course, distributor units also, both put together, they have shown one block. Now, what is the business of line scanning units? So the line scanning units sense and obtain the signaling information from the respective lines. So signaling is coming, say for example, from subscriber lines as well as from service circuit interface. So it has in the business of the line scanning is to sense and obtain, take out the signal information. What is the signal information that is coming from the subscriber lines? And what is the signal information that is coming from the service circuits? So it is the duty of the scanning units, line scanning units. It scans the lines for sensing the signaling information and also obtaining the signaling information from subscriber lines as well as service lines. Distributor units send out the signaling information on the respective lines. So it has to send out the information, say, let us see for easy understanding on the outgoing side. So you are making a call to other exchange. So you have to send signaling to other exchange. So this distributor sends out the signal information on the respective lines. It may be respective outlets for subscriber lines of the same exchange or on the outgoing trunks. So the distributor plays a role in sending out the signal information, whereas the scanning units is responsible for receiving the signal information or obtaining the signal information. Then operator console. So you want to work on this switching network for day-to-day maintenance. So you should have one PC-like thing, that is operator console. It is known as operator console. Operator console permits interaction with the switching systems for maintenance and administrative purpose. So day-to-day maintenance and administrative purpose also. With the help of this console, I can get the information. So in a particular time, in an hour, so how many calls have taken place through this exchange? What is the call details? So I can take even the customer user-wise also. So how many calls he has spoken on a particular day and what are the numbers to which he has made calls, and what is the duration of the calls. Each call duration also I can get through this operator console. So this is an interface with the system. So it will give out the information retrieved from the telephone switching network. Then now we will try to understand the control subsystem. What is control subsystem? In some switching systems, the control subsystem may be integral part of the switching network itself. Such type of systems are known as direct control switching systems. So control system can be located in the same switching or in the same telephone exchange. And it is also possible to decentralize the control system and keep in a bigger exchange. Okay, for entire, say, Vijayawada town, let us assume there are some 18 telephone exchanges. The entire control subsystem of these 18 exchanges within Vijayawada city can be placed in a centralized or the major telephone exchange. So control subsystems will not be available in the other distributed or smaller exchange. So that is called common control. So here, suppose the control subsystem is available in the same exchange, it is known as direct control switching systems. Switching systems in which control subsystem is outside the switching network are known as common control switching systems. So let us assume there are four telephone exchanges located in four geographical areas. So exchange A is only having control subsystem, and B, C, D, they don't have the control subsystem. The control functionalities of B, C, D are performed by the control subsystem located at the centralized exchange or the major exchange at A. So they are known as BCD, are known as common control switching systems, because they don't have the switching system of their own. It does not have its own control system for control purpose. So it has to depend upon the, in our example, in exchange A. Strouger exchanges are direct control systems. That means in Strouger exchanges, each exchange will have its own control subsystem. Crossbar and electronic switching systems are common control systems. In case of crossbar exchanges or in case of electronic switching systems, so you can have common control. You need not have a control subsystem in all the exchanges. A group of exchanges, exchanges control mechanism can be housed or installed or made available in a centralized exchange. So therefore, the crossbar and electronic switching systems, they facilitate the advantage of having common control system, so that all the other exchanges can be controlled sitting at a nodal exchange. All stored program control systems are also common control systems. In general, nowadays, all the latest systems are common control systems. Common control system, common control is also known as indirect or register control. So, since the control subsystem is not available in each and every telephone exchange, so we call this type of mechanism, common control, as indirect control. So indirectly, an exchange is controlled by another nodal exchange. So the other name for indirect or common control is register control. So these are the some of the basic introductory points I wanted to discuss in this session, part 3. So if you like my video, please subscribe to my channel and you can watch my YouTube videos on this link. Okay, I thank you for listening to my discussion.